Good morning. All right, and welcome to our worship service this morning. Both here in person, it's nice to see many people here in our sanctuary, as well as via Zoom. We've got a full morning in our service today, and it's a very, very special Sunday. First of all, we have a celebration of the baptism of seven young men from our congregation. The video that you were watching during the prelude was taken last May 3 when the young men were baptized at Swan Lake by Pastor Nick. Today we commemorate this important milestone in their lives, and we welcome them as members of the South Church. The second reason today is a very special Sunday is because it's the first Sunday of Advent. Advent is a time of preparation, waiting, hope, and expectation for the coming of the Messiah. It's a time when we look back to his first coming, his birth as an infant, and the second coming, his kingdom here. As we center ourselves for worship today, I invite you to join me in the call to worship that is printed in the bulletin, and we will read this in parts. Oh, that you would tear open the heavens and come down so that the mountains would quake in your presence. We have all become like one who is unclean, and all our righteous deeds are like a filthy cloth. Do not remember our iniquity forever. Restore us, O God. Let your light shine that we may be saved. Please bow your hearts and heads with me in an invocational prayer. Heavenly Father, sometimes it feels impossible. It all feels so impossible. Here we are again, watching and waiting for something to change, so that your hope for this world might come alive. But now, O God, the earth seems charred and burnt, and we are weary. There is weeping and wailing for people who have been lost, and a way of life that should be better. We are not certain that change will come, even as we pray for the heavens to be torn open. O God, come and teach us anew to sing again, for we need a new song. O God, come. This we earnestly and humbly pray. Amen. Our gathering hymn this morning is a hymn of thanksgiving. O come, ye thankful people, come. Please listen. And those of you who are participating via Zoom, of course, may sing along.
Save me, gather in, where the winter
We want to take a moment for everyone to greet each other, everyone else. Here in the sanctuary, please wave, give a virtual hug, say hello. Likewise, those via Zoom, please make your presence known as well if you turn your cameras on. Again, waves, virtual hugs, whatever seems appropriate in these times. It's good to see so many people participating today. As I mentioned, today is the first Sunday of Advent, and we light the first candle of the Advent season, which I believe is called the candle of hope and expectation, something that's also probably appropriate for these times. Amy Waltner will be lighting our Advent candle via Zoom, and as she does so, the junior choir from 2012 will sing Prepare a Way for the Lord. Please note that some of the members of the junior choir from 2012 include today's baptismal candidates. You guys sounded good. Our readings today include a confession and words of assurance that we will read in parts together. After that, we'll read in unison an affirmation of faith. Both of these readings, or all three of these readings, are printed in your bulletins, so I'd appreciate your following along and reading with me. Is there any hope for us? Can we be saved? Do not be angry beyond measure, O Lord. Do not remember our sins forever. Look upon us, we pray. Forgive us our sins. No ear has heard, no eye has seen a God like you, who works for those who wait for him. Mold us and make us into vessels you can use. Restore us, O God. Make your face shine upon us that we may be saved. And now in unison, an affirmation of faith. We believe that God is spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth, that God is light, and that if we walk in the light, as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, that God is love, and that everyone that loves is born of God and knows God. We believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, and that God has given to us eternal life, and this life is in his Son, that he is the resurrection and the life, and that whoever believes in him, though he were dead, yet shall he live. We believe that the Holy Spirit has come and convinces the world of sin, and of righteousness, and of judgment, that he guides us into all truth. We believe that we are children of God, and that he has given us of his Spirit. We believe that if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. We believe that the world passes away and the lust thereof, but that he does the will of God, he that does the will of God abides forever. Thank you. Our scripture reading today is a passage that Pastor Bob has chosen from the letter of Paul and Timothy to the church in Colossae. I will be reading Colossians chapter 1, verses 9 through 4, and this passage also is printed in your bulletin for today if you'd like to follow along. For this reason, since the day we heard about you, we have not stopped praying for you. We continually ask God to fill you with the knowledge of his will through all the wisdom and understanding that the Spirit gives, so that you may live a life worthy of the Lord and please him in every way, bearing fruit in every good work, growing in the knowledge of God, being strengthened with all power according to his glorious might, so you may have a great endurance and patience, and giving joyful thanks to the Father who has qualified you to share the inheritance of his holy people in the kingdom of light. For he has rescued us from the dominion of darkness and brought us into the kingdom of the Son he loves, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. This morning we are so blessed to have Pastor Bob with us today to bring our morning message and to share with us his thoughts on an Advent journey. Pastor Bob.
Thank you, Stuart. Good morning, everyone. I use a line that Pastor David has taught us. Good morning, South Church. And especially good morning to the candidates who have last spring been baptized, and we want to focus especially upon that accomplishment and significant milestone in your lives and in the lives of our church. Using the words of Isaiah that were referred to in our call to worship, on this first Sunday of Advent, we ask that God would restore us, that God would have his face to shine upon us once again, and that we would rejoice in God's gift of salvation. As the sermon title indicates, today we are on a journey. We are on a road through the next Sundays of Advent, and they will continue to follow this theme of journey, of moving, of progression. Future Sundays will call us to the need to prepare, to be ready, to be alert to God's Spirit that is in fact in work in our lives and in the lives of the world. We affirm that God is still with us. Isaiah seems to be emphatic with the words that he uses. Oh, that you would tear open the heavens, that you would come down so that the mountains would quake at your presence. I would say that's rather dramatic language. Shake things up a bit. And perhaps that's what we need. It seems that's what Isaiah's people needed. Something to get our attention. Something to shake us out of our routine and to reimagine God has visited us. God is visiting us. Advent is designed to accomplish this, to alert us that God has indeed come down to us into this rough and tumble world, in this world of gnashing of teeth. That God has come, and he desires not only to be here, but to redeem us, to restore us. And as we read the confessions of faith from the writings of John, it is John who tells us he has not come to condemn us, but that him, through him, the world might be saved. This visitation of God, in fact, will be repeated, and we will be reminded of it throughout this Advent season. One of the names that you will hear during this season is Emmanuel, which means God with us. Today's Advent journey will embody several key Christian expressions of our faith, and Stuart has already alluded to them. We acknowledge that there are two aspects to the Advent of Christ. The first, which is the beautiful birth story of Mary and Joseph and O little town of Bethlehem. I think we have sanitized it a bit. I'm not so sure that it was so peaceful for Mary and Joseph, or for that matter, that Bethlehem was so quiet that particular day. But nonetheless, it serves and tells a story that God was with them, and that this first Advent was a story beyond stories. How could God come into this world in such lowly conditions? But the other part of Advent is referred to as the return of Christ, commonly referred to it as the second coming, when he comes as Lord of Lords and King of Kings. And the time between these two Advents is what we call the church age. Now, while it's true that the church is incredibly diverse, with many colors and flavors of worship expression, there are two practices which are common to all Christians, as far as I know, and they are the common practices of baptism and of Holy Communion. And today we will focus on both of them. Today we will acknowledge that seven of our youth were baptized this spring. And today Christ invites each of them to the table of the Lord. And he invites each of you who have made public profession of Christ to this table as well. It is truly a thanksgiving table where we give thanks to Christ for what he has done. As we also look at the calendar, we know there are other things converging on us this Sunday. We have just celebrated Thanksgiving. We will be observing communion. We will be acknowledging baptismal candidates who have now submitted to baptism. So the agenda is full. A lot of things have converged upon one Sunday. I want to begin by addressing especially the seven candidates who were baptized this spring. I want to say to you, welcome to the body of Christ, the church. You are not only members of South Church now with your baptism, you are members of something much larger. As the book of Hebrews says, we are now all joining a great cloud of witnesses spanning both time and eternity, past, present, and future. Last spring, you joined that vast heavenly throng, that universal cloud of witnesses, by your confession of faith in Jesus Christ and by being washed in the waters of baptism. Now, as you well are aware, COVID has changed a lot of things. And we were not able to properly welcome you and embrace you at that time. And so today we're trying to pick up some loose ends. We won't do it like we normally would. We'd like to have a receiving line. We'd like to give you some hugs and some encouragements, some pats on the back, and a good fellowship meal. But things have changed. This is the new normal for right now. I want to say to you, candidates, our baptismal members of the class, when I was trying to think of what to say, I was having trouble. I didn't know what to tell you, what to say. You see, I wasn't your catechism instructor. I didn't baptize you. And consequently, I don't know you as well as I wish I could. Because catechism is a time of learning about each other, to hear each other's stories of faith and of hopes and of dreams and of me sharing some of my stories with you. And so I pondered at length of what to say. What should I speak about? And I, like they say, had brain freeze. Nothing was happening up there. And so I'll tell you what happened while I was searching for words and while I was contemplating. As is the custom for me when I study or prepare messages, I have soft music playing in the background, just instrumental music, no words, just the music. It's one of the best TV stations I have. Out of 200, at least there's one I like. And on the screen, I just looked up at that time while I was, giving thought. I looked at the screen, and it names the composer, it names the artists, and it names the title of the selection that is being played at that time. And so while wondering what to say, I looked at the television, and the selection that was being played at that time was entitled Dancing on the Ceiling. I didn't know there was a number like that. But I was looking for ideas, and I said, well, Lord, this maybe is it. How do I build on such a thing and such an idea? And I want to tell you, I can't dance on the floor, much less the ceiling. That's what this particular number was entitled. So the point I took from this is that is how this year has been. We all want 2020 behind us. I've heard that several times. Because it's like an upside down world. It's like trying to dance on the ceiling. An expression I've heard from different people was, everything seems to be 2020'd. Like this year has canceled plans and maybe even dashed some hopes. Young folks, let me tell you, that's how life is and how it can be. It's like upside down. It can be like dancing on the ceiling. And I can hear you saying, oh, now, Pastor Bob, you're getting a bit dramatic. You're talking like all those old people do. And I plead guilty. I am one of those old people. But I remember the older folks when I was young saying that. And now I know they were right. But let me assure you, at some time or another, you will join with Isaiah and you will say, Lord, I wish you would open the heavens. Lord, I wish you would come down. Lord, I hope that you would cause your face to shine upon us once again. Lord, save us. We need a Savior. You can read secular history, or you can read the New Testament or the Old Testament, and you will find that this is a reality for people of all ages, and that God's people are not excluded. They have experienced as much of the frustrations of this world as anyone. Now, if that is true, why do we have a day or a season of Thanksgiving, which we have just observed? You know, we could, I guess, just as well have a day of griping and complaining and telling God how he messed up and how we wish things were better or different. I know people like that. Their cup is always half empty instead of half full. I saw a cartoon some time ago of a very unhappy looking man. His beard was like a stubble field, and his hair was unkempt. He had red eyes, and he had a sad and a mad look on his face. He was standing in line to be checked out at the grocery store, and as he was up to the counter and that friendly lady running the cash register and the checking out his items, you know, as they do, they try to be bubbly and happy, says, "Sir, I hope you have a good day." And on this man's t-shirt was written the big words in bold letters, "Don't tell me what kind of day to have." Lord, don't tell us what kind of year to have either. 2020's been different. We can become cynical. We can become unhappy about life, and we can find nothing to be thankful for. But you see, folks, Thanksgiving is not just about taking an inventory of all the good things that you have. If that were the case, then I suppose the wealthiest people would be the happiest and the most thankful. I don't think that's necessarily the case. That is part of Thanksgiving, taking an inventory of your blessings. The hymn, after all, tells us, "Count your blessings, name them one by one, and be reminded of what God has done." That's part of Thanksgiving. But what do you do when your cup is not full and overflowing, when you don't have a good day or a good year? What do you do when life takes you on stormy seas rather than on quiet waters? Biblically, Thanksgiving is more than inventory. Biblically, Thanksgiving is a philosophy or an approach to life. It is a worldview, so to speak. It is the persuasion that God is always with you. And that's the message of Advent. God has come to be with us. It says, Hebrew 13 says, "Never, never will I leave you or forsake you." And out of that worldview comes the psalmist's words of conviction, "Lord, you are my helper. I will not be afraid." The psalmist had a view of life and of the world that gave him conviction and gave him solace that God was with him. Or you consider the text that was read this morning from Colossians chapter 1, the prayer that Paul has for his people at the church at Colossae. "May you be strong with all of the strength that comes from his glorious power, that you may be prepared to endure everything with patience while joyfully giving thanks to the Father who has enabled you to share in the inheritance of his saints. He has rescued you from the power of darkness. He has transformed us into the kingdom of his dear beloved Son, in whom we have redemption and the forgiveness of sins." Wow, that's something to be thankful for. Young folks, and all of us who are believers in Christ, this is what you signed up for. It's a high calling. This is your heritage, young folks. but you're not alone on the journey. Do you know who else signed up with you? This church did. They invite you to walk with them, the walk of faith. But there's someone else who signed up with you, who said, I'll never leave you, I'll never forsake you. Someone, in fact, who died for you. Someone whom we call Emmanuel, God with us. I think you know who that someone is, and if you don't, you should take your catechism over again. I think you know the answer. Christ has promised never to leave us or forsake us. And that's a philosophy of life, that's a worldview that we all need. And only Christ can give. This is a worldview. This is a foundation that will keep you on solid ground, even when the world compels you to dance on the ceiling. Father, ground your people. Bless these 7 young men who have professed your name and who henceforth will attempt to follow you. May we be an encouragement to them, we pray, in Christ's name. Amen.
Thank you for reminding us that Thanksgiving is a journey and that life has its ups and downs and that we can be thankful through all of them. Today's anthems are recordings from the Cherub Choirs of 2011 and 2012. The Cherub Choir of 2011 also included members of the baptismal class of this year. I remember you guys when you were much smaller. You looked a little more angelic than you do today. Janet and Lisa are nodding their heads no. Wendy says yes. But please enjoy the music from years gone by.
What a melody!
Oh, that was good. What do you guys have against girls? I think maybe by now that some of that has changed, I guess. But this is the time to have this class share their faith story. And I've told them to be brief. The procedures and all the arrangements have been made via phone. And so we will have you come up alphabetically according to first name, as you see them listed in the bulletin. And as you come up, you may speak here at the platform, at the pulpit. There is hand sanitizer here if you feel like you need to use that. And then as you are done and you leave the stage, there are Bibles and a certificate of membership that your parents or whomever you have selected to present that to you may come to the down on the floor level and present it to you at that time, and you may return then to be seated where you are right now. So, with that having been said, I want to welcome the class, and I ask Bo Miller to begin our confession, and we will follow without further. We will not announce each of you one by one.
All right, this thing on. All right. Jesus has always been one constant in my life, and one constant relationship. It's been one that's ebbed and flowed throughout the years, admittedly, but one that's remained nonetheless. Originally, I don't really have one, like, big faith story I can point to in my life. It's just always been more of a gradual and slow burn relationship with God. Although, as I've grown up, I found my faith becoming stronger as I formed my own opinions on the matter and realized just how serious this all is. So really all took off in high school, to be honest, and it's been quite the journey so far, and it's one I hope to continue on taking with you all. Thank you.
I can't really talk about my journey without giving thanks to someone who was very instrumental in leading me on this journey to becoming a member of this congregation. That person is my mom. She's been so instrumental to getting me into, you know, getting me into talking about Jesus, finding my love for Jesus, wanting to become a member of this congregation, from getting us to church every Sunday at a very young age, enrolling us in Sunday school. After Sunday school, answering any questions, being glad to answer any questions that we would have about God, or to the best of her ability. I would just like to thank her very much. I'm so thankful that she was there to help me on this journey.
My faith story has personally been like many others of people here. You know, I kind of had the cookie cutter faith up until eighth grade. You know, do what your parents say, just kind of love the Lord in your heart. But then, as I got older, especially in high school, the biggest thing that helped me through my faith was my group of friends. You know, the Bible classes, they helped a lot. But being able to talk with my group of friends late at night, you know, about the Bible is just something that I'm so grateful that I've had, and I wouldn't be here today without them and my parents. Everybody's been great role models, and I would just like to thank you all for being so instrumental in making me who I am today.
Well, I never really had one moment in my life that just popped out to me, but I remember one night I was just lying in bed thinking about things and decided to accept Christ into my heart. Catechism really helped to bring forth the ideas of what I believe in and helped me to understand it. And one person who really affected my faith was Dr. Reese, because he helped so many people through NDS and Community Garden, and he does so much for people. So that really affected me. And my parents also, like driving home from church, answering all my questions about God and faith and having late night talks. So yeah.
Like all the other candidates, I've never really had some sort of specific event where I discovered Jesus or anything like that, but I can say what's important to me. I believe in God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. I believe that the words and teachings of Christ are a model for all people to base their actions on, that we should seek to be peacemakers in all life, and that we should help those in need. This is why I chose to be baptized. I want to follow the teachings of Jesus to make the world a better place, despite my flaws, I suppose, however bad the world may seem. So.
Okay, so far it's been a pattern. Not many of us have had a big faith story. And same here. I've had, even though I've been raised as a kid who's come here almost every Sunday, slowly, gradually going down, I've still had faith. But I think one person that helped me embrace that faith was our past pastor, Pastor Nick. He taught us in a way that wasn't too upfront like a school teacher would, but he didn't do it in a way that was too little. He was calm about it. Like, he taught us in his own way that made us feel comfortable with it and let us embrace it in our own kind of pace. And I feel that's one of the big, big factors of how this happened. So thank you, Pastor Nick. If you probably can't hear this, but thank you.
Well, I've been going to this church since forever. I've been going to Swan Lake since I was old enough to, and I've gone to the academy since fourth grade. So I've definitely been brought up in the faith. But then a few months ago when we got the choice if we wanted to be baptized or not, that was kind of my chance to make a decision completely on my own, because I didn't really have any obligation to get baptized because I already had been baptized as an infant in my mom's church. But I think that infant baptism was more my parents committing to raising me up in the faith, which they've done, but it wasn't really anything I did because I wasn't old enough to have any idea what was going on. But getting baptized the second time was me, I guess, taking control over my faith, and as I go on to college or wherever after, even if there aren't people around to encourage me in my faith, I can still stay strong on my own.
Those who are baptized into Christ have also been baptized into his death, so that if you died with him, you shall also be raised with him. Joyfully give thanks to the Father, who has qualified you to share in his inheritance of all the holy people in the kingdom of light. For he has rescued us from the dominion of darkness and brought us into the kingdom of his dear Son, whom he loves, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. Amen.
Lord, we thank you for these seven young folks who have stood up and publicly confessed their decision of spirit and mind to follow you. We ask your blessing upon them in Christ's name. As a congregation, we want to officially receive these young folks, and you will find in your bulletin a welcoming section to the young, to the new members, and would we read it together as indicated? These persons now present, presented to you, have witnessed to their faith in Jesus Christ, and they offer themselves as companions in our obedience to Christ. It is our privilege and joy to welcome them into the family of faith. Your expression, faith. This is renew our walk with Christ. In your coming to us, we are newly summoned to become a community in which the wholeness of Christ is realized. We freely receive you, even as Christ received us, to open ourselves to him. Truly, that's a very profound theological statement. We are now one family. We will, at this time, partake in the Lord's table. We're doing it a bit differently because of COVID. I hope that as you came, you all received a container of bread and cup. It's a wafer. If it is not gluten-free, so if that is an issue with you, be aware of that. Did anyone not receive one? Who needs one? The ushers will bring one to you. Okay, then the procedure will be for us to read this unison reading, and then after we are completed with that, we will partake of the Lord's table. And young folks that have just shared your testimony, a very special welcome to you, to not only the table of this church, but the table that Christ has prepared for his people. Let us read in unison. The cup we share is a new covenant sealed by Christ's blood, which was shed so the sins of the world might be forgiven. The bread we share comes from many grains brought together to form one loaf, so that we are many brought together to form one church universal, the body of Christ on earth. We drink this cup, eat this bread with thanksgiving. As the bread is broken and the cup is shared, we proclaim the Lord's death until he returns to gather his church from every nation, every tongue, and every tribe. You may partake at this time. I failed to mention that those of you who are watching via Zoom were prepared and shared with us. We invite you to do that. Even though you are not with us in person, we want you to be with us in spirit. I would invite you to a time of prayer. Merciful God, we come to you this morning with thanksgiving. You have blessed us in so many ways, ways which we do not deserve. You have invited us to this table, your table, to dine with you. A table prepared for whomsoever will. A table prepared for those even in the byways and the highways of life. On this first Sunday of Advent, we bow in reverence and in awe to think that what the good news is, that the eternal God has become one of us. To experience life and its struggles with us. You join us in our struggles and you rejoice with us when we rejoice, and you weep with us when we weep. You have called us by name. You know who we are. And furthermore, you have given us your name. You claim us as your own. We are the sheep of your pasture. You have chosen us long before we chose you. Today we celebrate seven young men who have stepped forward to say to you and to the world, that they intend to follow Jesus Christ, that they believe in a God who has been revealed to us in flesh, in Christ. We also have received both cup and bread today.
to proclaim that we are fed and nourished by a gracious, merciful, and bountiful God. May we not leave this place without remembering that where two or three are gathered together in your name, that there you are in the midst of us. May we silently, for a moment, contemplate that truth. In the name of the Father, of the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen.
Our tithes and offerings today will help support Mennonite Disaster Service, and the Sunday School offering today will help support the Bethany Food Pantry. For those present in our sanctuary, please feel free to leave your offerings and tithes in the baskets in the foyer of the church, and those participating via Zoom may mail their contributions to our church or drop them off at the church office. If you have any announcements or concerns, any joys, or anything else you would like to share, we will welcome that at this time. For those in our congregation, please feel free to use the microphones at the front of the church. And after that, we will turn to our Zoom participants. Please be mindful of the announcements that are in our bulletin. Our annual church meeting is next Sunday. Wednesday evening is a youth Bible study, as well as Wednesday is a day of prayer and fasting. Also, if there are loved ones that you would like to honor or remember with a poinsettia, please contact Cheryl Wallman at Fenzel's Greenhouse. Are there any other announcements or joys, concerns, anything else that people would like to share, please?
I forgot to say that when you leave, there is a receptacle or trash basket. You may put them in there as you leave, or you may take them home with you.
Thank you. Anyone else? If not, we'll turn to our Zoom worshipers as well. Is there anybody who has an announcement? Please don't forget to unmute your microphone if you would like to share something. It's good to see so many people with their cameras on as well. Okay. If there are no announcements or things that you would like to share, I'd invite you to bow your heads in prayer with me at this time. Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning. It's been a long year, and we need you now more than we ever did. If there were ever a time that we needed less distraction and more focus on what really matters, it is now. During this Advent season, we ask that you direct our hearts and our minds toward you. Please fill us with your Spirit, bringing fresh restoration, renewal, peace, and joy. Please forgive us for the times we have worked so hard to be self-sufficient, forgetting our need for you and for living independently of your Spirit. Forgive us for letting fear and worry control our minds. Forgive us for the times we haven't followed your ways and have lived distant from your presence. Thank you that your ways are greater than our own, that your thoughts are far deeper and that your blessings are far richer than what we deserve. Thank you that you had a plan to redeem and that we share an inheritance in your kingdom of light. Thank you for your daily presence in our lives, that we can be assured, no matter what we're facing, that your heart is toward us, your eyes are over us, and your ears are upon our prayers. Heavenly Father, we especially thank you today for Bo, Ben, Gabe, Gavin, Philip, Trayton, and Tyler, and we pray that your spirit will always dwell in your heart, in their hearts, and we thank you for their lives and their testimonies. And Father, during this Advent season, may we be reminded of your promises to us and your fulfillment of them. Thank you, Father, for hearing our prayers today and always. Amen. Our sending hymn this morning is Hark the Herald Angels Sing. Before we listen to that, there are a couple of reminders as well. For those worshiping in the sanctuary as we exit today, please exit first, starting from the back and working your way toward the front of our sanctuary. Please be mindful of social distancing, and if you want to carry on conversations and fellowship, we might do so outdoors even though it's a little cool and windy. Hark the herald angels sing.
Hark the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King. Peace on earth and mercy mild, God and sinners reconciled. Joyful all ye nations rise, join the triumph of the skies. With angelic hosts proclaim, Christ is born in Bethlehem. With angelic hosts proclaim, Christ is born in Bethlehem.
One more reminder before our spoken benediction. Participants in our worship service today via Zoom, please feel free to stay on the Zoom channel after the service has concluded for fellowship and saying hi and greeting one another as well. People of God, people on the road, keep awake. The Lord is coming. Get ready. Go in peace and have a good week.